Good morning, good Sunday morning. To God be the glory. This is the day that the Lord has made. We have come to rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. It's Sunday morning. Yay, to God be the glory. He has brought us through yet another week and has allowed us to gather on this Sunday morning for worship. And not only that, we have made it to the last Sunday of the month. I don't know about you, but it seems to me that July just flew by. Now, again, I'm just saying, I know it's me. For some of you, that might not be your testimony, but it seems like July went quickly by. But we're still here. We're still standing. God has blessed us. He's kept us, and he has been watching over us. And for that, we are indeed grateful. And so you know what time it is. It's time to like, it's time to like, it's time to share. It's time to start those watch parties, and let's get ready to worship the name of the Lord. God is truly worthy of all of our praise, and we don't want to be selfish. We want to take this opportunity to share the word of God, to share songs and prayers to those who are in need, and we want it to reach persons all across the world. We have been so blessed by the number of people that have been able to connect with us that would not ever really be able to step foot into our church. And so we are grateful for this opportunity. Sure, we want to be back in church. We would love to be in the sanctuary, but we also have to look at all the positives and be so grateful for persons that have been able to connect with us and grow with us and share with us during these times simply by logging on or by going on Facebook Live. And so we're grateful and we are appreciative for the streaming services and our teams who work so hard and do this for us each week. And so to God be the glory. And so let's prepare to pray. But right before I do that, we want to welcome our visitors. If this is your first time sharing with us, welcome. Welcome to worship. We are so glad that you are here sharing with us. Hang in here, stay for a while, and enjoy the worship experience. You will see a link that would allow you to connect with us. We would love for you to fill that out. Please fill that out so that we can connect with you and welcome you to worship and give you an opportunity to partner with us, gain more information about our church. And so that gives us the opportunity to do that. So please click on that link. I say it each week. Don't worry. We won't harass you. We are not going to bother you. We're not that kind of church, but we will welcome you. And if you want to, drop your name in the comments or say I'm a first timer so that we can show you some love right here during this time. And so again, we welcome you and thank you so very much for worshiping with us today. And so let's pray and invite God's presence as we move further along in our worship experience this morning. God, thank you so much for this day. We are grateful, God. We are thankful. There is so much going on. There is so much turmoil. There is so much tragedy happening all around us. But God, we are still grateful. We are blessed. You are providing for us. You're covering us. You are protecting us. God, you are keeping us in the midst of. And for that, we are thankful and grateful. And so we leave the weight of the world. We leave all of the stressors. We set that aside right now, God, and we focus on you. We turn our hearts, we turn our minds towards you in worship this morning, the true and living God. We thank you for just being an awesome God. We thank you for being a provider, for being a healer, for being a way maker. God, we thank you this morning, and we ask you to have your way in our service, be in the midst, God, going home. Go on jobs. If somebody's even in a car or sitting in a park, wherever they may be, God, go and be with them this morning. We give you praise. We give you honor. We give you glory. But God, right now, we really do pause just to say thank you. Thank you for being an amazing God. Thank you for being God and God alone. So have your way. Move by your spirit and get the glory. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Thank God and amen. Amen. Come on, put those hands together. Let's get ready to worship the name of the Lord with our worship team through song. Turn up the volume and let's praise our God this morning.
says the Lord is high above the heavens. We've come to give him all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. It says give God the highest praise. We're going to shout hallelujah to your name, Lord. Yes, God. We're going to lift you. We're going to praise you. High above the heaven,
the Lord is high above the heaven,
and his glory above the nation,
and his glory above the nation.
The Lord is high above the heaven,
the Lord is high above the heaven,
and his glory above the nation,
and his glory above the nation.
Oh, the Lord is high above the heaven,
the Lord is high above the heaven,
and his glory above the nation,
and his glory above the nation.
The Lord is high above the heaven,
the Lord is high above the heaven,
and his glory above the nation,
and his glory above.
So give God the highest praise and honor, give him always, and all God's people say, Halle, Halle, Hallelujah.
Halle, Halle,
Halle, 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 Halle, Halle, Halle,
Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle,
Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle,
Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle, Halle,
Halle, halle, halle,
halle, halle,
halle,
halle.
Well, God bless you and good morning. I praise God for you today. I hope your spirits was just uplifted through song this morning. We thank God for our music ministry and for them providing us with great quality worship and uplifting songs to uplift our spirits. I hope you have had an amazing week, a good week, and we thank God for this opportunity to worship together right now, even before we go into the few announcements that we have and our offering time. Why don't we just go ahead right now and have a moment of fellowship? So drop the city that you're in right now. Drop the state that you're in right now. Let's fellowship with each other. Drop it in the comments right now. I would love to know who's where you are and who's worshiping with us this morning. Listen, while you are doing that, I want to remind you today that for our young people, they will have their time in the Word. So the crew, you get ready to log in at 11 a.m. this morning. That will be your time to share in the Word. We thank God for Brother Demise, our youth director, who is providing quality lessons, great practical applications that our young people can use to grow in their Christian walk. So please make sure adults and parents, you make sure they are logged in at 11 a.m. today. Spread the word, teens, and invite some of your friends to jump on. Let's evangelize. Let's witness. This is a great opportunity for us to build up our teens in the Word of God. So let's do that today. Make sure they're on at 11 a.m. this morning. I want to thank all of you who have filled out our church surveys that we sent out. Some of you mailed them in. Some of you stopped by the office and picked up a copy. For all of you that replied through the email for our church surveys, that information has been so beneficial in helping us to provide some direction and look to gain some clarity about the direction we will be going in. I will be making some official statements on next week and sending out some official correspondence. So be on the lookout for that as we give the state of our church and what the direction for our ministry will be for the fall. So thank you for that. Also, we will be sending out correspondence as it relates to our renovation efforts that we're getting ready to embark upon as we get ready to come into the latter part of the summer and getting ready to go into the fall. So we're going to gear up for that. I need you praying now for the success of this project, for the success of our renovation. I believe the budget is already met in Jesus' name. And I thank all of you for your readiness and receptiveness to get ready to respond to this initiative. I'm excited about it. It's been a long time coming and well overdue. So I'm excited about this next effort that we're getting ready to embark upon. As we get ready this morning, let's get ready to worship God through giving. I've been so encouraged by so many of you that give weekly online. So many of you tell me every week that when it comes to this time in our service, you're at home and you're waving your offering envelopes like we would do if we're there in the sanctuary. And we thank God for you. And I believe God is honoring it. I really believe God is honoring our efforts. He's honoring our commitment and our consistency. And I know that you will see the blessings in your life because God honors generosity. He honors givers. He honors tithers. And I pray right today for the blessings over your households as you continue to honor God in your consistent giving to the house of ministry. So with that being said, let's get our offerings ready this morning. If you're giving online, let's get ready to go to Givelify. Let's get ready now to text our offerings. Let's get ready to go to our website right now. Whatever resources that you use or whatever means that you use to honor God, let's get ready to do that now as we get ready to give. For those of you that's writing out your envelopes to bring them by, to mail them in, let's get ready to wave them as we participate collectively in this time of giving and honoring God with our offerings for this morning. I want to pray. I want to bless them today as we give in a collective way. Father, we thank you this morning for all of the resources and the gifts that you give to us. Thank you, God, for being our sole provider. And God, we thank you for the daily resources, the streams of income, the ability to earn income. We thank you, God, that you're sustaining us even in the midst of these times. We thank you that you are the source of all of our supply. So, Father, for every household, for every giver, And for every person that's sowing today, I pray for them. I lift them up. And I pray, God, that they will not have any lack in their life. And God, that you will continue to open up windows and pour out blessings that we will not have room enough to receive. I thank you, Lord, for the ABC Church and for how you're sustaining our ministry. And you are proving yourself to be God and the miracles that you're working for us and on our behalf. We thank you now. Bless these offerings. Bless these gifts. Bless every heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we're giving now, let's go back into the sanctuary to receive our worship team, and then we'll come back with the word of God for the morning.
How many of you know that Jesus brought the sunshine? Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Ready to go to the Word of God this morning. I have had great joy in sharing in this series throughout the course of the month, Keep Calm and Carry On. And today we want to conclude this series with another topic that I want to touch on this morning as the Holy Spirit shall guide us today. And I want to invite your attention to the Gospel of John, chapter 13, beginning at verse 34 and verse 35. The Gospel of John, chapter 13, beginning at verses 34 and verses 35. There you will find these words. Listen to what Jesus says to his disciples. He says, "A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." Let's hear that scripture again. A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know you are my disciples if you love one another. As the Holy Spirit shall guide us this morning, I want to conclude this series by simply talking about this morning, keep calm and fellowship. Or if I would subtopic it, I would tell you simply, keep calm and look out for one another. Here in the 13th chapter of the Gospel of John, it now marks, if you will, a transition from Jesus now shifting from his public ministry to now shifting to a more private, intimate ministry with his disciples. There's now a shift from Jesus teaching in synagogues and teaching crowds and teaching the mass followers to now these concluding chapters in the Gospel of John. Jesus shifts to the moments where he now, in the 13th chapter, is gathered there with his disciples in the upper room. And he begins to share now more in an intimate way with his core disciples who have been with him since the beginning of his ministry. Now, the things he begins to share with them are things that are intimate, that are close and dear to his heart. He now begins to finally prepare them and ready them for his death and his resurrection and his ascension and the time that he will no longer be with them. Because ultimately it would be these 12, it would be this core group that would carry on the work and the gospel that Jesus ultimately had called them into assignment to carry out. And so now this transition shifts. It begins in the Gospel of John, the 13th chapter, with Jesus now gathered with his disciples there in this upper room. And the verse that is pivotal for us this morning and the verse that we highlight and we focus on is interestingly sandwiched in between some very interesting conversations and dialogue. It's sandwiched right as Jesus talks about Judas and the ultimate betrayal that he would receive from Judas. And it is followed by Jesus predicting that Peter would ultimately deny him. In the midst of all of that, this verse that Jesus now gives as instructions to his disciples is within the context of Judas's betrayal and Peter's denial. It is sandwiched in between the selfish tendencies and motivations of Judas and the self-confidence that Peter relied on and totally relying on himself that leads to him denying Christ when he gets around that fire. Sandwiched in between all of this, Jesus now gives these instructions to his disciples about how ultimately they should treat each other. Now, what's interesting when we get ready to dive deeper into this verse this morning that is paramount for us today, we will begin to discern that this new command, as Jesus calls it, shifts from the previous instructions of how Jesus has instructed his followers and his disciples of how they should love their neighbors and how we should take care of our neighbors, to now how we within the household of ministry, the household of faith, within our spiritual community, how we should interact and how we should treat each other. Now, I believe this is important for us this morning because it is important for us, especially in the time where many of us, we are no longer in our local assemblies. And it is so easy for us to end up living in isolation, disconnected, and solely focusing on ourselves. That this word that the Lord has for us this morning is going to push us to a place that you and I keep at the forefold and the threshold of our mind and in our spirits, what it means to be a part of a spiritual body and a spiritual family. That it is not God's desire that you and I function and live in isolation, but you and I must maintain our sense of community and the communal fellowship, even when we have to keep social distance. That the spirit and the nature in which we carry and function must still thrive in the midst of a society now that is being challenged to be socially distanced. Then this passage today helps us. It pushes us to a place that challenges us to maintain our sense of community and our sense of care for those in the household of faith, right? So here's the thing that challenges us this morning. See, one of the things that this is going to help push us to the place to understand is this is at the crux of what Jesus is after. See, there are those who know Christ but do not act responsibly as Christians. I'm gonna say that again. There are those who know Christ but do not act responsibly as Christians. You know Christ, but you don't act responsibly as a Christian ought to act when it comes to how we care for one another. See, what I really believe, a lot of us, when it comes to church and in our spiritual community, we really treat the church and our spiritual community like we do our restaurants. We go into the restaurants and the only thing we are concerned and we care about is how are we going to be served? How are we going to be satisfied by the dining experience? And we want everybody to wait on us, to serve us. We want the chef to prepare our meal just right. We want the hostess and the waitresses to be at our beck and call and to wait on us so that our experience will be satisfying at the end of our dining experience. And I think some of us carry that same mindset and attitude into our churches and into our spiritual communities. That the only reason we are there is to get our needs met. The only reason we are there is for everybody to serve us. And so we want singers to sing to us. We want the preacher to preach to us. We want everybody to wait on our children. We want everybody to serve and do all of this stuff for us, but yet we are reluctant and restrained to doing anything in return. And that's where we're challenged at the core of who we are and what God is calling us to be as Christians and as believers. So listen now with a fresh set of ears to what this command is that Jesus gives to his disciples. Listen at it again. He says, "A new command I give you, love one another as I loved you, so you must also love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." A couple of observations that I want to just lift up for us this morning as we explore this text in a little more detail. The first thing I want you to observe is this. Number one, notice it's a command. Jesus says, a new command I give you. He is not just giving some casual suggestion. He is not just making some reference or giving some great idea. No, Jesus says, a new command I give you. There are other commands that we have been given. We know the Old Testament and the Deuteronomic law. We know that Jesus has taught them and given illustrations in such cases as the Good Samaritan of how you and I ought to treat our neighbors and we ought to treat others. We know that one of the commands in the Bible, and Jesus has taught this, that we are to love God and to love our neighbors as we would ourselves. And so the emphasis has been on how you and I have treated our neighbors. But now notice the shift. Jesus says, a new command I give you, love one another. He is exclusively now talking about how the disciples ought to treat each other. He is not talking about how we should act and function within our external society, of how we should treat others that we may not necessarily know or we are not in a communal relationship with. No, he now zooms in on those who are within the concentric circle of these disciples, those who claim to be his followers, those that he has taught, those he has spent time with him. He looks at these 12 disciples and says to them, y'all love one another. Yes, he looks at them and says to them, a new command I give you. I've talked a lot about how you should treat others, but now I want to focus and teach you how you should treat each other. Man, what a word that I think we need to explore. And I think that's a word and an on-time word when we are isolated from our church buildings and we're not seeing each other on a consistent basis. The thing that you and I must be concerned about, and Jesus commands us, that we must love one another. That there has to be, and a command that Jesus gives us, is that there has to be a love that is evident among the spiritual family, among the believers, that you don't see reflected everywhere else. He says, a new command I give you, that you must love one another. So the first thing that we understand from this passage this morning, that it is a command, not a suggestion, not just a good idea that Jesus gives, but he commands you and I that we ought to love one another. So if we ought to love one another, notice the emphasis then that you and I ought to what? I give you love one another. So the first observation is this, it's a command. Secondly, it is a combined effort. It is a combined effort. We ought to love one another. See, the shift in this is different from how you and I ought to treat our neighbor. In other passage, in terms of what the Good Samaritan did for that poor man that was left in that ditch, was not necessarily the Good Samaritan was not necessarily looking for something to be reciprocated back to him in return. See, what you and I do as good gestures as Christians for others that may not be a part of the household of faith, we are not necessarily looking for anything to be done or reciprocated in return. No, the love that we demonstrate for our neighbor is we do things for people, we help people, we share with people, we give, we support without necessarily looking for anything to be given back to us in return. No, he took that man, put him on his beast, and took him to the inn, paid for his attendance, paid for his stay, and he wasn't looking for anything in return. That's how you and I ought to love our neighbors. But now there's a shift here when it comes to how you and I ought to love within the household of faith. It is a command that he's given, but now it is a combined effort. We ought to do this for each other. Then this type of love, and it is a reciprocal relationship. That's right. It's a reciprocal relationship. Love one another. I am to love you, and you are to love me in return. It is a reciprocal relationship. You're not just coming here soaking and receiving, but guess what? You are also giving so I can soak and receive. This is the reciprocal relationship. What I understand about most of the relationships and the ideal that God has given us for relationships is relationships work best and function best when they are reciprocal. I wish I had a witness here. Nobody wants to be married to somebody. Nobody wants to be friends with people and be in intimate relationships and things are not reciprocated to each other. It doesn't have to be reciprocated in the same kind, but you ought to reciprocate that love that you have for others in your relationships. So it's a combined effort. Jesus says, love one another. I'm loving you, you are loving me. And guess what? When we are demonstrating that, then no one is lacking emotionally and physically and spiritually within the household of faith because it is reciprocal. My God, you are a stingy person when you are only concerned about getting your needs met, but you are not looking to give in return. Jesus says, no, disciples, followers, the kind of love that you demonstrate with each other is a reciprocal relationship. That's what he says. It's a combined effort. It takes two. It takes both of us giving 100%, not holding anything back for those that are part of the household of faith. It's a combined effort. It's a command. But then thirdly, notice how we ought to do this, because the reality is most of us, we don't have healthy and wholesome examples of what this kind of love looks like. There's somebody under the sound of my voice right now saying, well, I didn't come from that kind of home. I don't come from that kind of community. Thank God that we have an example to follow. Watch this. He says, a new command I give you, love one another. Here it is. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. So the first thing we understand this morning that it's a command. Two, it's a combined effort. Then three, it's a challenge. Why is it a challenge? Here it is. He says it. As I have loved you. So regardless if your mother hadn't set this example, regardless if your father hadn't set this example, and regardless if your siblings don't function this way, regardless if your friends or your frat or your sorority doesn't function this way, he says, listen, I've already set the bar. He says, I've already set the bar of how you can function and you ought to function, because this is the same type of way that I have treated you. As I have loved you, you now love one another. Wow, that's a challenge, isn't it? It's a challenge because somebody right now is saying, well, others ain't loving me this way. Jesus says, No, you cannot, you're not off the hook because it may not be being reciprocated to you. He says, no, you do this because this is the way that I love you. And based upon my love for you, I now challenge you to love others the way I've loved you. So you're not off the hook because you may not have had somebody in your life to love you this way. Jesus says, no, based upon my love for you, I now call you to a higher elevation and responsibility for how you ought to love others. It's a challenge because we should imitate the love of Jesus to our other brothers and sisters. As I have loved you, you now love one another. Now, let's go a little bit deeper. When we look at this love and how we ought to imitate this love that Jesus has for us, I believe there are about four things that you and I need to imitate when it comes to others. The first one is this. We ought to, when we think about how Jesus loves us, then what I understand is Jesus has accepted me. Jesus accepts people. He accepts people. Yes, he accepts people. When now we understand this love and love as Jesus has loved us, the first thing I know is he's accepted people. He's acted with compassion. He has an attitude of a servant, and he's an answer to a sin problem. Help me preach in here, if you will. Notice a couple of things. He says, now, here is the example. Here is now the challenge of what you and I ought to ascribe to when it comes to how you and I ought to love others. We ought to be accepting of people. We ought to act with compassion. We ought to have an attitude of a servant, and we ought to be an answer to a problem. When I think about how the Lord has loved me, when I think about how Jesus has opened his arms to receive me, I thank God this morning for the simple fact that he's accepted me. He tells us, come to me just as you are. You don't have to wait to be anything. You don't have to wait to be perfect. There are some that wouldn't accept us the way that we are. But is there anybody under the sound of my voice this morning that can shout today and give God praise that the Lord accepted you just as you were? But thank God, even though he accepts us as we were, he doesn't expect us to stay as we were. He accepts us as we are, broken, messed up, dejected. He accepts us, but my God, when you come to him, he doesn't expect us to end up staying the same way we came. Is there anybody under the sound of my voice this morning that can give God praise right now that while others rejected you, while others couldn't receive you, while others couldn't handle all of the matters of your life, thanks be to God this morning that God opened up his arms and he accepted you. My God, isn't that a challenge for us? If we're going to love the way Jesus wants us to love, we must be more accepting of people, more accepting of people. That's one of the challenges that we have. If we're going to imitate his love, we have to be more accepting. But not only do we have to be more accepting, then we must act with compassion. We must demonstrate compassion towards our brothers and sisters. We ought to be accepting, and then we must act with compassion. Act with compassion. When I begin to act with compassion, it moves me beyond me. It moves me beyond being self-centered and self-serving. It moves me beyond of thinking about what I'm going to get out of it. And it moves me to a place of what am I able to do to help somebody else. Now, here's the beauty of this. Here's how it becomes reciprocal. When I'm thinking about your needs, and you are thinking about my needs, there is nobody's needs that are going unmet. That's the beautiful picture of what we get of the community in Acts chapter 2. It says all of the believers had everything in common, they shared, and there was no need that went unmet in that community. That's the beautiful picture of what we have when we create a healthy and wholesome spiritual community where Christ is at the center. We act with compassion towards other people. I'm so encouraged every week when people call or text me and they ask the question, Pastor, is there anybody who needs groceries? Is there anybody who needs some assistance? I'm willing to give. I'm willing to sow. That's the kind of community that God wants us to create. And ABC and our partners, I'm telling you this morning, that is the challenge of the church during this season of isolation from the physical building. Because we are disconnected and because we are not in close proximity to each other, the challenge for us is how do we care for each other when I ain't seeing each other? You know the old saying, either out of sight means out of mind, or absent makes the heart grow fonder. When God has done a work and changed my heart, and when I'm really trying to imitate the love that Christ has for me, I am accepting people and I am acting with compassion towards people, and then I am displaying an attitude of a servant. That's right, an attitude of the servant. When you look at this 13th chapter of the Gospel of John, when you go up to the preceding and opening verses in this text, you will notice that Jesus demonstrates servanthood by washing the disciples' feet. He demonstrates, he constantly positioned himself and the attitude that he had as a servant, not someone to be served, but someone who is now serving. You need to ask yourself the question, who is God calling me to serve in this season? Or what does my service look like in this season? I know there are a lot that are out of work, unemployed, and we're all trying to figure out this new normal. But in this season, can I caution, can I challenge you? Don't solely be focused on you and all of the problems and how you've been solely inconvenienced. Because that I would encourage you, if you would pause and look around you, there are people who are far worse in far worse shape than you are. My brother and my sister, and the challenge now becomes, how can God use me to be a blessing in this season? Listen, I believe what is going to happen in this season and what I'm praying for somebody today, you can't serve like you used to serve. Now you can't usher because ain't nobody in the building. Now you can't sing because ain't nobody got choirs. You can't do a lot of the things that we have been accustomed to doing. So you got to be prayerful right now in this season and ask God, God, what is the new way you want to use me? How can I be a blessing? How can I help the church? How can I help the spreading of the gospel and touch lives? I can't stand on a wall now. I can't greet. I can't do a lot of these other things. But God, I believe if I open up my heart, you will begin to show and give me discernment and of who I am to serve and how you can use my life in this season. Listen, we have to accept people. We have to act with compassion. We have to have an attitude of a servant. And here's the other way that Jesus loved us, y'all. He was an answer to our problem. He was an answer to our sin problem. That's what he was. He demonstrated his love for us by answering a problem, being an answer to a problem that we were still trying to figure out. Thank God he answered our sin problem. Can I tell you, as I talk to you this morning, that you that's under the sound of my voice today, you're on this earth to be an answer to a problem. You're not here to be a problem or to cause problems. You are an answer to a problem. The gifts, the talents, the skills, the abilities, the resources that you have at your disposal is an answer to a problem in this earth. What you got to pray about, what you got to seek God about is, God, show me the problem that I have the gifts, the skills, the resources, and the abilities to answer. That's what you need to do. The world will be a better place when you start using your life to answer the problems in this world. You are here not by happenstance or mistake. You are here to be an answer to a problem in this world. Thank God that the answers lie in you. Some of the lack that we see, some of the chaos and the confusion that we see, a lot of the unrest, a lot of the needs that we have in this world, it is because people who are answers are acting like they are the problems and acting like they don't possess the answers to the problem. You're praying for God to do it, and God says, I've already put it in you. I've already given you the skill. I've already given you the idea. I've already given you the plan. I've already given you the resources. And God says to us today, let's start being the answers that he put us in the earth to be. When we start imitating the love of Jesus Christ and start loving each other as Christ has now given us the example, we'll be more accepting, we'll act with compassion, we'll have an attitude of a servant, and we will be the answer to a problem. Here's the last thing as I bid you good morning today is, as we look today, we understand that in this text, first of all, this love that we ought to display for one another, it's a command. It's a combined effort. It's a challenge. But then lastly, here it is as we close, it is a commercial. It is a commercial. It is a commercial. Well, what do you mean by that, Sheridan? Look at verse 35. Verse 35 says, verse 34 says, a new command I give you, love one another as I loved you. So you must love one another. Now, when we do this, watch what verse 35 says. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. What Jesus says to his disciples and what he's saying to us is when we imitate the love that he has for us and the love that he demonstrates for us to others in our community, when we do this, when we function this way, we give the world a preview of what it's like to be loved by God. We give the world a glimpse of what it's like to be in the household of faith, and what it's like and what heaven is like and what it is like to exist in the kingdom of God. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Man, that's a big if, because it's hard for us to do. It's hard for us to function this way. But Jesus says, when we do this, everyone will know that you are my disciple. Isn't it interesting? He didn't say anything about singing. He didn't say anything about big Ephesus. He didn't say anything about all of the trappings that you and I get so bogged down in that we call church. No, Jesus says how you and I love one another will be the commercial that the world needs to know that you are my followers. You know the purpose of a commercial. The purpose of commercials is to introduce something or to give a preview of something or to point you in the direction of a product or to point you into the direction of a store. Jesus says, when we love each other like this, it points the world and everyone else in his direction, because this type of love is not being displayed everywhere else. No, when you and I love each other this way, it points people in the direction of him. And I think in the times we're in right now, the church universal has its greatest challenge. You and I, we have our greatest challenge. that now more than ever, we must demonstrate our love for each other. We must work hard to create fellowship. We must work hard to demonstrate care and concern. We must work hard to make sure we are imitating the love of Christ when we are outside of the walls of our church buildings. Now more than ever, the church has its greatest opportunity to show the world who we really are. Now more than ever, we have the opportunity to evangelize and to send a sign and to show this world what we as believers, we are really made of. Now more than ever, we have the greatest opportunity before us in the current crisis that we're in to let the light of Christ shine in our life. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Everywhere I go, I'm going to let it shine. I'm going to start in my home and I'm going to let it shine. I'm going to let this little light of mine shine everywhere I go, that I can help make this dark world a much better place. So the command for us this morning, the challenge for us this morning, is in this season, you and I must love one another. So that means I'm gonna look out for a brother. I'm gonna look out for a sister. I'm gonna demonstrate care and concern. I'm gonna demonstrate compassion. I'm gonna be more accepting. I'm gonna act with compassion. I am going to be an answer to a problem, and I'm going to have an attitude of a servant, and I'm going to let that be reflected in my life. And I'm going to start with the people in my own house. I'm going to start by being accepting of those in my house. I'm going to start by acting with compassion with those around me. I'm going to start by being having the attitude of a servant, and I'm going to be an answer in my own house. And I'm going to take that spirit, and then I am going to demonstrate it to my spiritual community and to the greater world. My brothers and sisters, that is our challenge, that we don't rest in isolation, but we seek for fellowship and we seek to create a thriving spiritual community that doesn't have to solely rely on a physical building. Thank God for the body of Christ. And thank God today you and I are members and we are part of that body. So we, like never before, must work hard to maintain and to thrive in being the church that God has called us to be in this season. I want to pray today that God opens up your eyes this morning and opens up your heart for new ways and new possibilities for you and I to demonstrate our love for one another. Lord, I thank you this morning for the word. I thank you for the challenge. I thank you for opening us up. And even now, God, we're not going to be stifled by the limitations, but we're going to ask ourselves a question in this season. What does this make possible? God, we're not going to be confined by all of the things that we lack and we don't have. But God, I believe there are new ministries that are getting birth right now. I believe there are new servants that you're raising up right now. I believe there are new ways that you want to use us for your glory. I thank you, Lord, for the new church, the fresh church, the new wine that is emerging in this season. We're not going to dwell on old wine and things of our past, but God, we're ready for the newness. We're ready for the freshness. So even now, Father, I pray for people that have that this becomes their season to step out, to step up, to serve in new, fresh ways. I thank you, Lord, for the new ideas, for the new ministries that are being birthed out of this season. I thank you for all of the new possibilities that we have to be the church that pleases you. So Lord, we take heart to this message. Now let us receive this word and apply it to our lives so that, God, we will be able to carry out this command of loving one another. In Jesus' name, we say together, amen. Before we go this morning, as always, I want to take this opportunity for someone to come to Jesus, to someone to come back to him, and also for someone who doesn't have or are not connected to a spiritual family, for you to get connected today. If you're here, three things. Ask yourself, if Jesus were to come back today, would I go back to live in eternity with him? Am I secure in my relationship and in my salvation? If you're not, then a simple thing I want you to do is say, just drop in the comments, today I want to be saved. Put your email there and we're going to be in contact with you in just a few moments. If you want to rededicate your life, you've strayed, you want to come back, just drop your name in the comments and we're going to reach out to you. And if you're not a part of a spiritual family, you don't have a pastor, you don't have a spiritual family, and you want to come into this spiritual family that we have that is trying our best to work out this kind of love that we just finished talking about. If you want to come into the family, you want to come into the fold, drop your name there and we'll be in contact with you to talk about your next steps. I want to thank you for joining us this morning. I hope you've been blessed by the word today. If the word has blessed you, just drop that in the comments this morning. I thank God and I look forward to sharing in these comments and reading these comments and how we can better serve you. And let's work hard together to demonstrate this kind of love that Jesus has commanded us today. God bless you. Have an amazing week. Let me bless you before we go. Now may the peace, the power, and the presence of our Lord be with us until we meet again. And all of God's children say together, amen. Have a great week. Have an awesome week. And we'll be in touch with you soon.
To come, better is coming for you. If you believe it, you ought to be excited. You ought to dance through wherever you are. For better is coming for you. And if you're glad about it, you want to get excited here. Come on and clap your hands. The best is yet to come. Hallelujah. Come on right here. Say, hold on.
Hold on, my brother. Don't give up.
Hold on, my sister.
Hold on, my sister. Just look.
See, there is a master plan.
There is a master plan.
The best.
The best.
Hallelujah, the best.